Well, hello again, and welcome to another episode of the Hyperion Adventures Podcast. I'm Tom. As always, I'm with my gorgeous, super lovely, and luxurious wife, Michelle.
What? Thank you, sweetie. Hi, everybody.
So good to have you with us. We were recording this episode on Sunday, August 16th, 2020. Midway through August, we're making our way through the summer. It's been hot this week.
Yeah, it's been crazy hot. Crazy hot. And as much as I miss Disneyland, this would not be a fun time to be there. It is wicked. And of course, there's fires going on.
Yeah. Well, so we're
good.
We hope everybody's safe with the fires and everything. Yeah. But yeah, we're a bit spoiled on the West Coast. Obviously, in Florida, you're used to it being hot and humid for, 11 and a half months out of the year. But here in Southern California, it gets hot and dry and sometimes humid, but it's been really warm and a little humid over the last couple
right,
days,
exactly.
As a matter of fact. Nothing compared to anything you're facing probably for most of the country and definitely in Florida, but it has been a little hot here. And so dealing with that as best we can. But yes, this is the one time when I'm not missing that Disneyland.
That's right.
It's not open at this point. So thank you for joining us today. In the future, you'll find us most everywhere you get podcasts. However, the very best place to find us is on our own website, HyperionAdventuresPodcast.com. And while you're there,
you will want to sign up for the newsletter. There's something today in my tip that's going to be in the newsletter.
No, I have more work to do, apparently, that I didn't know about, but that's great. I'm happy to add more stuff into the newsletter. Yes, please sign up for the newsletter. We put out a lot of information just to kind of have you be in the Hyperion Adventures know in the newsletter, including some stuff I'm going to bring up in just a moment today. And we also, last week, remember, we recorded our top five Disney quick service restaurants a day early because Michelle had to work on Sunday. We had a late email come in from the newsletter that unfortunately we didn't get to because of the fact that we were recording a day early. But I wanted to make sure and get to it here because I said, if you wanted to send us stuff on our list anytime afterwards, we will be happy to add it to a future episode. And Nate and Serena, the DVC duo, who are such wonderful friends of ours. They are great people. They have a great blog. Check out dvcduo.com. Yes. Check out their blog. They wanted to chime in with their favorite quick service restaurant.
Oh, cool.
So they said, "Hi, Tom and Michelle. We hope you're both doing well. With so many great options around all the Disney parks, we decided to focus on Walt Disney World." So they didn't put these in a specific order. They just listed them.
Did they?
I don't know. They didn't put a number next to it, so we'll just go with it anyway. Satuli Canteen. Mm-hmm. I think I said Canteen so many times last week. I know it's Canteen. Satuli Canteen from Pandora. Ronto Roasters at Star Wars Galaxy's Edge. The Tangerine Cafe in Morocco in Epcot, is closed right now. There's a little concern that the Tangerine Cafe might not come back. So keeping our fingers crossed for that one to come back.
It is a great one.
Mm-hmm. Captain Cook's at the Disney's Polynesian Resort and Spa. And the Mara at the Animal Kingdom Lodge at the Jumbo House.
Nice. So,
great list. Picks. Thanks, Nate and Serena, for chiming in. We really appreciate it. So speaking of that, we love hearing from you. This is a very interactive show, as you can just see or just heard, or whatever the case may be, depending on where you're finding this podcast. You can always hit us up on social media. We're very active on social media. We're on Twitter, at Hyperion Podcast, Facebook, Instagram, and Pinterest, at Hyperion Adventures Podcast. We are on YouTube. That's me mentioning you might be seeing this. We are on YouTube. If you want to find us on YouTube, just do a quick search for Hyperion Adventures Podcast and we'll come up there, and then you just hit subscribe, and anytime we have a new video being released, you will know about it and you can watch it at your leisure. Okay. And if you ever want to email us, just like Nate and Serena did, you can always hit us up at our Gmail account, HyperionAdventuresPodcast@gmail.com.
Right. We love hearing from people. We love hearing your responses to the show, some great feedback that we've gotten. We really appreciate that. So thank you, everybody.
Yes. Thank you, everybody. Thank you for listening. Thank you for contributing. Thank you for just being a part of our Hyperion Adventures world. We really appreciate you so very much. We have, going on to a couple other notes, and we mentioned this last week, but I'm going to mention it again. We have joined the Parks and Monorail's Most Magical Virtual Run Team with others from the Disney community, including Nate and Serena, right, who we just talked about. Together, we have accepted the challenge of the Broadway Cares Virtual 5K, and we're raising money to make a difference for men, women, and children across the country who are affected by COVID-19, HIV, and AIDS, and other life-threatening illnesses. Mm-hmm. Now, I had put out there on social media this week, we're trying to hit this goal with this team, right, of getting to $1,000 between the 10 teams that are within this, right, the 10 podcast bloggers that are within this community here, mm-hmm, in this team. And so we're all trying to reach this goal. I think originally we only had 8, so it was 125 per team.
Right.
Then we got to 10, so now it's $100 per team. Well, we had set that goal a little bit higher than that. We had set our goal at $250 because we thought we could do better than that.
Right.
We were right. And thanks to some very extremely generous, yes, friends, family, listeners, we have already met that goal. As a matter of fact, we were up to $280.
Yeah.
Thank you to Patricia. Thank you to Heidi and Mike. Thank you to Larry and Marty for contributing.
Right.
And I put out on social media that I was going to do something that kind of alluded to. I put the picture of us in the pirate costumes,
right,
up.
I know. I was like, I'm in that picture too.
Said one of us,
okay,
not both of us. It's just going to be me. And I said when we reach our goal, and I was going to announce it this weekend to try and inspire people to help us reach our goal. Well, we already reached that goal, but that doesn't mean I'm not going to do it. I am going to take on that challenge. So at some point coming up here in the next few weeks, I am going to dress up in that pirate costume,
which is so good,
do a little dance, lip sync to a song that I'm going to let the listeners choose out there. You get to pick, nominate songs. We'll put it out as a poll of which song I should lip sync. And then we will put that video up on YouTube, on all the social media,
yes,
and everything. So that'll be done because we've already met our goal. Now, because we've already met our goal, we think we can do better than that.
That's right.
We are going to set an even higher goal. I'm going to double it. I'm making it 500.
Wow. Yeah.
So if we reach 500 donations, I am going to, I have a couple other costumes, and so maybe I might even add another one in if we seem to get closer in, but I'm going to put on a kilt and dance a little Scottish jig lip sync to another song as well if we reach that 500. So that's the next goal that we want to reach. Please donate to us. If you donate at least $10 to us, we have some of our old school Hyperion Adventures podcast logo magnets, nice, refrigerator magnets. We will send one of those off to you. And
while supplies last.
And of course, we'll get this all out to you. But more importantly, you want to see me in a kilt.
I know,
doing
I do.
A little Scottish jig. Which will be terrible, but it should be hilarious. So please help us out if you get the chance. But we will be getting that pirate video out, and I will be asking for nominations for songs this week, and as well as eventually putting out a poll picking between maybe the four songs that I think are the best, and,
right,
and we'll figure it out, or the four songs that get nominated the most. So also this week was out in the newsletter, and we posted it on social media and announced on the podcast last week. It was our first new category that we're adding to the Hyperion Adventures Disney Hall of Fame, the second annual,
yes,
Hyperion Adventures Disney Hall of Fame. And what our category was for this week was Best Disney Villains. Now, that was across all Disney properties. It could be live action, it could be animated. It didn't matter if they were original Disney properties, if they were Disney properties that were brought in later, whatever the case may be.
Right.
And we put it out there for people to nominate. But first, before I get to what the actual nominations were, we wanted to get to our five that we added to this list. So Michelle, let's get to your list first.
All right. So I tried to pick ones that I thought obviously were intriguing and tried to really get a broad base from across all the different universes of the Disney company. So, and again, no particular, I guess the order is here is not my, which ones are my favorites, but more the order they came out.
Right. Well, I'm going to say this, we're kind of just listing these right now. We are eventually going to do a top five favorite Disney villains episode. So we'll probably put these in more in order. And some of these I've just kind of thrown in, at least for my list. I don't know if your list too, because I want them to get nominated. It doesn't necessarily mean that they will be, I mean, our top five lists shift all the time anyways.
Right. Day to day.
By the time we actually get to this episode, I may have a completely different top five list, but we wanted to get to them anyway. So I'm sorry. Go ahead, Michelle.
All right. So again, in order that they appeared, the Disney's first full-length film, the Evil Queen
from Snow White and
from
the Seven
Snow
Dwarfs.
White and the Seven Dwarfs. Darth Vader.
Very
Star
nice.
Wars. Uh-huh. Ursula from Little Mermaid. Yes. Hopper.
Oh,
from A Bug's Life.
A Bug's Life. Very underrated film.
I know. Mm-hmm. I know. And then Thanos. Thanos. I don't know.
Thanos. Thanos from the Marvel.
Potato.
Yes. Potato tomato.
Hot Phineas and Ferb.
From the Marvel Cinematic Universe, of course. Like that list. Very good.
Thank you. What about yours?
My list, I'm going to start with Hades from Hercules.
Oh, yeah.
One of my favorites. Captain Hook. I love Captain Hook. I mean,
yeah.
He's just,
he almost made mine.
He's such a good bad guy, but he's silly and hilarious at the same time. From Peter Pan. Mother Gothel. I love Mother Gothel. I think she's devious and nasty. And I love
predicted
Mother
that
Gothel.
Was going to be one of yours.
Scar from The Lion King is on my list. And yes, I am a Star Wars fan. Darth Vader needs to be on my list. So
good list.
Yeah, thank you very much. So let's get to it. So as we said, we put this out on social media, on through the newsletter, out on the podcast to get nominees for this next, for our final ballot, which is coming up in November, December time or whatever. And you had to be like nominated and at least seconded to make the list.
Okay.
So you had to have at least two people voting for you at some point on there. So here are the nominees that will be on that final ballot. Hades from Hercules made it. Yes. Dr. Facilier from The Princess and the Frog.
Yes.
Another great villain. All these are great villains.
Yes.
I mean, Disney villains are so good.
Right.
Jafar from Aladdin made it. Ursula, from The Little Mermaid made it. Captain Hook, of course, made it from Peter Pan. Mother Gothel from Tangled. Scar from The Lion King. Maleficent from Sleeping Beauty. I'm not surprised. You know, Maleficent is very popular. Cruella de Vil, who, by the way, if you ever run into Cruella de Vil at the parks, she is a hoot.
Yes.
She's so fun. She's, of course, from 101 Dalmatians. Another one that's a great one if you ever run into the park. Gaston from Beauty and the Beast. Great one. This was an interesting one. Yzma from The Emperor's New Groove made it. Yeah. So that's a kind of an underdog there to make it onto the list. The Queen of Hearts from Alice in Wonderland.
Nice.
Yes.
Yeah.
The Evil Queen from Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs made it. Oogie Boogie from The Nightmare Before Christmas.
Yes.
I actually thought that he would be on your list. I was a little surprised he didn't make it.
Yes,
Thanos from the Marvel Cinematic Universe did make it, and so did Darth Vader from the Star Wars film franchise. So those will be the nominees that will be on your final ballot when we get to that coming up in November and December, and we'll have a new category for you this week. It'll first be released on Tuesday when the newsletter comes out, so if you subscribe to the newsletter, you'll know what that is to begin with, and then later on the week, we'll have it out in social media. We'll announce it again on the next week's podcast, and the voting will go all the way through this week and the next, and then 2 weeks from now when we get to that show is when we will announce the nominees for that category.
Cool.
So that's enough housekeeping to get before we get to our main topic of the week. But I just want to tell you, we have lots of stuff for you this week, including a couple of new shows are heading to Disney Plus. One exploring the wildlife of Disney parks, that's coming to Disney Plus, and also another that is revisiting an infamous TV special.
Yeah.
Exciting stuff. But let's get to our main topic of the week. Yes, this week's main topic, we decided, you know, we've explored a lot of, actually last week, we were, you know, quick service restaurants. We were going more casual and everything. And we've been daydreaming for a long time about Disney trips. I mean, right. It's been a while since we've been able to get anywhere Disney. And so, you know, we're just wishing and hoping and maybe someday we'll get to go back eventually. And while we were dreaming about it, we're like, well, let's go all out with our dreaming. And what if money was no problem when we could go out? So we decided to explore Disney's luxury side. What would be a Disney experience if you just wanted to go crazy and, you know, either money wasn't a problem for you and you could just go out and live it up, or if you just decide, hey, you know, this is going to be the splurge trip. So we're going to break this down in a few different ways. I think we're going to start with Michelle looking at the resorts throughout Disney. I'm going to break down a couple of the really high-end dining options. And we're going to have another one where we're going to really break down luxury dining just as a five favorite. But I'm going to hit some of the really high-end stuff. And then eventually we're going to get to more Disney experiences as well. And then we also have some people who chimed in through the social media or on through email or whatever that also gave us what their dream Disney vacation would be like. So let's start with Michelle and get to the resort part of Disney luxury. And I noticed you have a PowerPoint presentation there. Which is great. I love it so much.
This time I felt like PowerPoint was going to be the easiest because it had some visual prompts for me to talk about.
All the more reason, by the way, to watch the YouTube video of this because the PowerPoint presentation she has will probably go up for our slides throughout the episode. So just so you know.
And I figured we're talking luxury, so I pulled out the pearls.
I see it. Looking lovely as always.
I was going to do some other bling. You're sweet. I was going to pull out more bling, but I thought, let's not go over the top here.
You didn't want to bring out the tiara.
I know. I was trying to figure out how could I wear something, you know, on my head, but in bracelets and rings and stuff. But yeah, I digress.
Very nice.
Thank you. So going to talk about the luxury resorts first, as you mentioned. And Disney calls them their deluxe resorts. And so there's some that are just resorts and some that are vacation club villas and everything. So, and I think people really know what they are, and they generally categorize them by area. So you have your Magic Kingdom resorts, Epcot area, Animal Kingdom resorts. Those are the ones that are, you know, considered the deluxe. And then for the vacation club villas and suites, those are also considered the deluxe one. So anyways, that's the categories we're going to talk about. But in those categories, because we could talk about luxury Disney forever. Yeah. I mean, there's a lot. It was really hard to curtail how much detail to go into because there's also the whole side of Disney luxury that is, you know, private dining experiences at parks and things like that, that, you know, that could be a whole episode on its own. So,
yeah, I mean, it's interesting because people think of Disney and you think of, you know, cheesy hotels that are themed after the mouse and the other characters and, or, you know, going out and getting a burger and fries and, you know, going to the parks and riding till you puke, you know, and, and yes, they certainly could do that.
Right.
But there are so many, if you really want to dive into it and really go a higher end, you can with Disney for sure.
Exactly. So figured really focus right now on the most luxurious resort room types that they have. And there's really like four categories. So they have bungalows, cabins, tree houses, and three bedroom villas. Those are their top of the line, pretty much type of resort rooms. So starting with the two bedroom bungalow. And first of all, I want to mention that all of these have full on kitchens, a washer and dryer, et cetera, within the units. So starting with the two bedroom bungalows, which are at the Disney Polynesian Villas. So, they're pretty neat. If you ever see, if you've ever seen them or seen pictures of them, they're on stilts over the water.
Yeah,
so
you
that's
can't miss
really
them when
cool.
you're anywhere when you're out by Seven Seas Lagoon. You can really see them standing out there.
Right. Yeah. So they're right there in the front in the water there. They do have a large private deck and with lounge chairs, a large table out there, and they even have some hanging chairs, which is kind of fun to be outside and just kind of in like a swingy type. they also have, they call it a small plunge pool. You know, it's kind of like of a larger size, I guess I'd say hot tub, but it's not a hot tub. It's a little pool.
Okay, that you more can of go a cold with. Tub, essentially.
Right. Mr. parents without children.
Thank you very much. I got a lot of love on social media this week. Parents without children, yes. So you mean adults?
I know. So the bungalows, they sleep eight, and their decor is kind of like a 50s theme, which is kind of surprising to me. They do have some touches that look Polynesian within there, but it is surprising how much it's more towards a 50s style
theme. Is it kind of like a 50s, like, because tiki bars really took off in like the 50s. Is it kind of like a tiki bar look? Or
no, it's like kind of like
just prime 50s
cafe.
Primetime cafe, really?
But with the colors are more muted. The colors are more like what you would think of,
okay,
of a Polynesian.
Interesting.
But they do have spectacular views of the fireworks at night.
I'll bet.
You know,
I'll bet.
In fact, when they built those, they covered some of the views for some of the other villas back there.
Oh.
But and they take up pretty much the most amount of points if you're going on the Disney Vacation Club plan. They're pretty, pretty high up there in points. So the next is the two-bedroom cabins, and those are the ones that are at Copper Creek.
Now, you were mentioning to me that you had never really explored the Copper Creek cabins before, but when you were looking at them, suddenly you're like, whoa.
Yes.
This is going to be on our bucket list of places to stay, right?
Definitely. This is this place. You know, I think because Copper Creek, I was just thinking, not that it was bad, but that it was just going to be a lot like Wilderness Lodge.
Which we love,
you know, but I never really thought about, you know, these cabins that they have on the water. And again, if you're ever on any of the boats, you can see them from the waterway there. But their decor is just stunning, just amazing. And that they have these areas with huge floor-to-ceiling windows that when you're in a sitting room, I mean, it's just very, very spectacular, but keeping with the theme of Wilderness Lodge, so that, you know, kind of pioneer national parks theming, you know. They have, they're also two bathrooms. They have a private porch, which is real nice. They even have a fireplace. I'm guessing it's like the one at Wilderness Lodge that doesn't really, not that large, but that doesn't really throw out heat. I don't know. Maybe it does, but.
Turn the AC, crank it all the way down and then light up the fireplace in the middle of August. Yeah.
That's true. Good point. Yeah. They do have a covered deck and they have a hot tub outside. Mm. It also sleeps eight. And as I mentioned, it's really very elegant, rustic decor. But the sitting area, as I mentioned, really has, and if you see these pictures, stunning, just wide open space, windows, et cetera. So it really looks like it has spectacular views of the lake from the inside.
Nice.
As well. So, yeah, this one just, it's, like I said, I had never really explored it. I thought, oh, a cabin, you know, we've enjoyed cabins. We do the ones that are at Fort Wilderness.
Yeah, which we enjoy very much.
Which we enjoy. Yeah. But this is obviously a much more elegant level.
Yeah, I know you were saying, like, you know, maybe we need to, you know, think about changing a trip coming up.
Right.
And figure out a way to do this with some people.
So, right, exactly.
We may work on that at some point.
Yeah, yeah. So it has a lot of space if you know, you had a family, even though it says sleeps eight, you know, that's, you know, talking about kids and fold out couches and things like that. But it does have a lot of space in there, and their deck outside, you know, it's really, really looks beautiful as well.
Nice.
Yeah.
We'll have to look into that for sure.
Right. So, and then the next one we mentioned, we're going to talk about are the tree houses, and those are in Saratoga Springs. Those are three bedrooms, but also just two baths. They're neat too, because they're like 10 feet off the ground as well. You know,
I mean, who doesn't want to be in a treehouse? It's just kind of cool. I was such a kid. Didn't you want to be in a treehouse?
Right. They're octagon shaped, you know, and so what it does provide is that the rooms have really great windows. And I guess maybe that's my thing, having, you know, natural light
great
come
views,
in a room,
yeah.
But great views of like woodsy views and things like that. To be able to look out at, even in the bedrooms, et cetera. So, you know, they also have a very large deck and table and chairs. And so it's a really, to me, it's more of a Zen kind of a place to go to. The rooms, because of, I think the shape may feel a little smaller, but it's still pretty spacious.
Nice.
Yeah. And then the last category are the three bed bedroom grand villas. Mm. You know, those are the vacation clubs.
That's another dream. I know you've been dreaming about it. One in particular for a long time.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly. Now, they're all a little different. They all have some similarities. The one similarity is they all sleep 12.
Wow.
But again, that's, you know, that's also using fold out couches and, you know, drop down beds, mm-hmm. things like that. But still very, very, you know, suitable for large mm-hmm. groups. So, and they're located at Copper Creek, Old Key West, Animal Kingdom, Boardwalk, Bay Lake Tower, and Grand Californian here in
Disneyland.
Right. Nice. So let's go through those.
Okay.
So, because they all, like I mentioned, they all have some differences. So Copper Creek, all the bedrooms have their own balconies and it, you know, in the floor plan, it's interesting because it kind of is almost like the end of a building. So you have some of the balconies facing one direction and then some, you know, one bedroom facing another direction, you know, the living room area has, living room has a long balcony as well.
Oh, okay.
Not so just even, the bedrooms.
Even another balcony that you can
right.
kind of more of a community. You have your individual for different bedrooms and then
exactly.
you have more of a community balcony space.
Correct. And it has one of the larger dining room table areas that seats 12.
Oh,
so,
wow.
You know. It's really spacious. It's got a lot of nice couch area there. So again, if you have a large group, whether you're just staying there or entertaining there, whatever you, it does seem a little bit more comfortable in what it provides in the sense of sitting area for people who are, you know, in the living area, because that's not the case at all of them.
Ah, okay.
So, Old Key West, it's a split level
okay.
of how they do it. So they have some of the bedrooms upstairs and there's several others that are like that. What's nice about this one is it has four bathrooms Ooh. In it as well. So it has a lot of, windows and balcony is larger, you know, for sitting, et cetera. The dining room table, surprisingly, is a little bit less, seats 8.
So, sorry, 4 of you.
Yeah.
You don't get to eat at the table.
I know.
Which might actually be a good thing. I don't know.
Yeah. Well, you know, and if you think like some kids might want to sit outside on, sure. you know, or whatever, I don't know. But anyways, yeah.
The kids table.
The kids table.
Some adults may want to sit at the kids table.
Right. The next one is the Animal Kingdom Villa, the Kidani Village one, because they're actually the two different Animal Kingdom resorts have very different layouts for
okay.
their three bedrooms. So at the Kidani Village, it's a two level. And so what they do with those is like the living room area is open on both levels. So you have then two stories of windows,
okay.
which is really kind of cool. So here also it has some community and some bedroom, balconies as well. So that if you're wanting to see the animals, you know, you can do that.
Of course. I mean, really, if you're going to stay at the Animal Kingdom Lodge, aren't you going to want to see the animals?
Right.
That's pretty much what it's about.
Yeah. Exactly. Now this is one where I mentioned that the seating area is not as well provided for as Copper Creek. So it has seating areas on both levels because that open space in the living area expands upstairs. Mm. So there's a little couch up there as well. So, you know, if you have groups that might want to sit in different areas or, you know, not all be clustered into the same dining room, living room area, it does give you that opportunity mm-hmm. as well. And the other bedrooms are upstairs.
Okay.
Okay.
Cool.
So, but at the Animal Kingdom Jumbo House, it is not split level. It's a single level, and it seems like it's on the top floors of those units. And what's really unique of this one is the balcony. It's like a semicircle. Mm. So you can actually fit a larger round table. You could, more people could fit out there if people are watching it. And so it goes... There's like three semicircles the length of your whole unit. So you have like, if you want to think of like two bedroom areas on the sides, and then the middle area is the community area.
Right.
So, and the other interesting thing about the layout that is on the Disney website is it appears to have a pool table.
Really?
Yeah. And I did some research. It seems like that's what people say is there, but there wasn't anything on the Disney website itself that designated that pool table. So I don't know if all the units have it. Some units have it.
Your results may vary.
Yes. So, but anyways, you know, I think with their balconies, that's what makes them really stunning and unique, is that they are much larger. And so you can fit more people out there, more chairs out there.
Yeah, it looks like from the picture you have there, it looks like easier to dine out on outside.
Right.
And, you know, sit out and watch the animals and have a meal at breakfast or have dinner or whatever the case may be.
So, but anyway, so that's Animal Kingdom Jumbo House. The next one that has three bedrooms is the Boardwalk Resort, the Boardwalk Villas. Again, this one also, which is nice, has four bathrooms. And it's also has the longest balconies. So it goes the entire length. Similar of what I was,
one long balcony.
Right, right. So, and you can access that balcony from various rooms. So it's kind of nice that, you know, it provides that. Mm-hmm. It has a really great large living area, kind of like really large in the middle, with dining room table and the other area with the kitchen. And then also a lot of nice couches.
Mm.
So
cool.
Yeah. And then there's Bay Lake Tower,
which is the one that you dream so much
about. Yes. Bay Lake Tower's ones, they're the ones when you're looking at that resort and you see these grand windows.
Yeah, if you look at the top of it and they're just this tall area of, big glass windows.
Right. And what makes it really nice, this is a split level, so there's those grand windows goes two stories, you know. And again, that you have that middle area that is your sitting area that you can be looking at it from both levels. So all three bedrooms do have balconies. And if you've ever obviously seen that resort, it's kind of like a curved shape. So you have that feature in it to have that areas that some areas may seem a little narrower than others, but it all works really nice. They have a large area for dining and, their couch space or sitting space in that regards is on, kind of, if you look at all the both units, the top and the first floor and the second floor, then you do have a lot of couch space, but it's separated. So,
okay.
The bedrooms are upstairs, or two of the bedrooms are upstairs, I should say.
Okay.
And then here on the West Coast, the Grand Californian. Mm-hmm. And so it also has four bathrooms. And I'm not trying to be obsessed about bathrooms, but it's nice if you are having a party that people aren't necessarily always having to use the restroom that is for the bedroom.
Also, if you're going to have 12 people in the room, up to 12 people, I mean, you don't want to be fighting for two bathrooms if you can help it. And one of the things, we should bring up about this is that, yes, these are ridiculously priced either for dollars or for points for some of these. But if you're coming with two or three families and you're splitting it with your points or money or whatever the case may be, then yes, it's still expensive, but it becomes a little more reasonable and you can live in luxury and you still have these great spaces kind of to be together, but also to separate yourselves, especially with some of these private balconies and your own bathrooms and whatever the case may be. So, it's one of the benefits of if you wanted to just go all out, invite your friends and decide that you're all going to splurge on it.
Exactly. So good point. So this one has kind of like that rustic charm also, and it has a lot of ample space for dining, for sitting. Again, the bedrooms all have their own balcony. It's split level. And it does have a pool table, and it mentions it on the Disney website.
Ah, okay.
So if you're interested in that, it's kind of like a game.
Think of a
game room. Yeah. It just seems like a fun, nice little feature. And again, if you have like a family, that could be a fun activity that some people are doing, and as other people, may just be sitting and enjoying the sights from the balcony.
Yeah.
So.
I mean, if you're going to have one of these rooms, there's no point in getting one of these giant rooms that there's so much about it. If you're going to just be at the park from rope drop to fireworks, you want to take advantage. This is going to be more of like something that you go to the parks. Of course you do.
Right.
But maybe you spend a little more time around the resort, a little more time in the room. If you're going to spend that much, if you're going to use that many Disney Vacation Club points, whatever the case may be, to get one of these, you should enjoy it to its fullest.
True. And, unlike, obviously, the more routine rooms, is that you have space to move around. You're not feeling like you're dodging people sometimes.
Right.
Or if you have a meal, whether you're bringing something in, having in-room dining or whatever, you're not feeling like, hey, one or multiple of us has to sit on a bed to eat.
We've all run into that, haven't we?
Right, exactly. And, even though it's a fully stocked kitchen and dishwasher and everything, and, you may not want to be using it to cook meals, or you may, but at least you have some of the conveniences. Like if we've talked about in the past, you want to have breakfast and, have space for people to be eating breakfast while everybody's getting ready and showered and dressed,
also,
et cetera.
Also, washer and dryer.
Yes.
Which you don't think like, oh, I don't want to do laundry while I'm on vacation.
Right.
But, you get into some of these hot weeks. One, you don't have to pack as much in a day where, the many more bags you bring, a lot of times you're being charged for that by the airlines. But then also, it's hot. Your clothes are getting sweaty. You may be changing clothes 2-3 times a day, possibly.
Exactly.
Having the ability to wash clothes occasionally, believe me, is from people who are Disney Vacation Club members and have had those rooms with the washers and dryers several times. It's a godsend.
Right.
It's so nice to be able to wash clothes occasionally.
So do you have a favorite of one of these luxury?
Well, I haven't looked into them as much as you have, but I agree with you about the Bay Lake Tower. Those always look spectacular. We love the view. We normally don't do a theme park view when we do Bay Lake Towers. We do a water view. For Bay Lake. And we love that. We sat out on our balcony for hours and just watched what goes on out there. The electrical water pageant, watching the pirates go out for the fireworks and stuff, thing. And just
we see the monorail.
Yeah, see the monorail. We've seen some interesting things like a ducks going after a turtle, or was it a turtle going after ducks? It was the weirdest thing, but it was hilarious. But we've just had the best time just sitting out there having a cocktail and watching, and the views that you
or
see
coffee
from those.
In the morning.
Yeah. The views that you see from those look spectacular. But I have to study more on the Copper Creek cabins because those look pretty cool too.
Yeah. So, like I said, those are their most luxurious type of rooms that they have, and obviously, like you mentioned, you could group up with multiple families and really be able to have that splurge. Type of experience.
Right.
And just the comfort, when you're in the park, you're getting worn out and you come back to the resort and it's a lot more calmer area to relax at, just adds to your, your adventure, but also to the fun of your resort.
Yep.
All right. So any questions or anything?
No, I think it's brilliant. And so many of those places I want to stay. Even the treehouse sounds really cool. It's kind of an interesting thing. Like I said, as a kid, you always wanted to have this awesome treehouse, and that looks like a pretty awesome treehouse.
I think the only thing with the treehouse that we experience with the cabins is there are sometimes you can go and it's very lush, and then other times, and obviously there's reasons that they would have to, clear the area and things. So I don't know how it would feel if it wasn't as lush.
Mm. Especially spending all that money or all those points or whatever the case may be.
But anyways, that's just one thought.
Interesting stuff. So great list, Michelle.
Thank you.
Look at the resort stays on the high end for sure. I'm going to take a quick look at some of the very luxurious dining options. And I mean, extremely luxurious dining options. We're going to get into, as I mentioned before, eventually an episode looking more at the signature and more of the luxurious dining experiences, maybe be 5 favorite lists of both of those things.
Right.
But I'm going to go extremely high end with this one so far. And I'll start over over here on the West Coast, mm-hmm. and we'll move west to east. And I started the Disneyland Resort. And we're going to start right with Club 33.
Right.
If you don't know what Club 33 is, well, you need to be a member or know a member to even get in there to dine. If you go to Disneyland and you want to see if it's kind of up above the Pirates, well, not Pirates of the Caribbean, partially by Pirates of the Caribbean, but more over
at New Orleans Square.
New Orleans, thank you. I'm like French Market, which is by there. Right. But no, New Orleans Square area. If you look up there in the evenings, a lot of times you'll see some lights up in the buildings up above and everything. That's Club 33. It's going out there. They've recently expanded it not long ago, and it's larger than it ever used to be. But to be a member of Club 33 as an individual, they vary on what you read online, so we don't know what is actually accurate. You can go and ask for yourself, I guess. Right. $25,000 just to start.
Right.
And then it's another $10,000 to $15,000 per year dues that you have to pay on top of that. Now, you get a lot of perks on top of that, including, you know, individual passes to get into the parks, a VIP tour, some other stuff like that. But the big thing, of course, is getting to go up to Club 33 and dine at their exclusive restaurant and in their lounge there. It's the only place outside Star Wars Galaxy's Edge at Oga's Cantina in Disneyland where you can actually get alcohol, by the way. But they have a really nice restaurant up there, high-end cuisine, great food, really wonderful chefs manning it. And that is like the place to go to. And at some point in Disneyland, we'd like to be invited. If anybody's out there would like to invite us, we would be happy to hit up that restaurant with you, because we would love to experience Club 33 at Disneyland, the OG.
Right. That is the OG, Club 33. In fact, at Disney World, it was only much more recent.
Right. Very recent, matter of fact. But there is Club 33 at Walt Disney World as well. They are separate entities. You have to, if you want to be a member of one, that doesn't necessarily make you a member of the other. Now, you may have some influence knowing some, you know, that you are a member. Like, you can invite somebody that's a Club 33 member at Disneyland into Walt Disney World and vice versa. So you may be able to get into some of those clubs, but they are completely separate units. Just because you're a member of Club 33 at Disneyland does not mean you're a member of Club 33 at Walt Disney World Resort. So another really high-end place is, we'll just talk about, we're going to talk more about Victoria and Albert's, but Victoria and Albert's, their chef's table is like probably the most high-end area that you can possibly get to in there. And it's a 7 to 10 course prix fixe menu, which is $250 per guest to get into, you know. And that, if you want to add wine pairings to that, depending on the wine pairings you want to add, it makes it, bumps it up to $355 to $400 per guest. And that doesn't include tax or gratuity.
Right.
So you have to throw that on top of it. But you're sitting there right in the kitchen with the chef. He's coming and he's making you your, you know, it's basically, he's just making you what he wants to make you. Of course, he'll ask you if you have any allergies, if there's things you like or don't like. If you just don't like seafood, they'll probably take seafood off the menu or whatever. But just incredible dining experience that is extremely high-end and tough to get into.
Right.
They also have one, by the way, at the Napa Rose at Disneyland. They have a chef's counter is what they call it. And really, it's a little different. It's not as quite as expensive as the chef's table at Victoria and Albert's, per se. And you can actually order off the main menu there. However, it's very exclusive in that there's only 12 spots per day that they give out. So you have to get there at the right time to get into this area to check it out. So it's really tough to get into. Most people never have the chance. They go in there, they try, they ask, but it's gone all the time. So really interesting. Now, if we're going to talk about high-end Disney dining, we have to go back to Disneyland and talk about 21 Royal, which, if you don't know what 21 Royal is, if you know the old Dream Suite, which is right above Pirates of the Caribbean attraction there, where you used to be able to spend the night, you may still be able to spend the night there. I don't know. They have still the beds and everything there in place as if it's the Dream Suite still laid out as the Dream Suite. However, what they do now is they have an evening dining experience that costs $15,000 for up to 12 guests. So essentially $1,250 per guest.
Right.
And by the way, if anybody is out there willing to invite us, we are willing to put up $250 a piece. If you guys can cover the other $1,000 per each of us, so $2,000, we're in. Okay. We're in for this. So just let us know if you have any interest in that. So what this is it's a fully immersive experience at this place. And I'm going to go through a little bit of this. I got some of this from some people. Actually, it was at the Disney Food Blog who had experienced this. So I'll read a little bit off of what the website says and then go a little bit of what their night experience was so you can kind of have an idea. Now, these are at $15,000, as you might expect.
Right.
They definitely do sculpt it to what you prefer. Sure. It's not like you're paying $15,000 for the same menu that the people that did that for you. So here, kind of off their website, is what they describe the evening is going to be. So they say, on the evening of your 21 Royal experience, your guests will arrive at the majestic Disney's Grand California Hotel and Spa, where they will be greeted by the hotel's valets. We've been watching Downton Abbey. Valets. Once your entire party is assembled, they will be given a VIP escort to the site of the evening's festivities. First, signature cocktails are served by professional butlers, again, Downton Abbey. Do they have footmen? In the salon. And then everyone is invited out to the patio for a casual reception. You and your guests will also have time to explore the different rooms and discover some of the more magical features. So you get to kind of peruse through the dream suite and take a look at it, you know, while you're having cocktails and enjoying the evening and also sitting out there on the balcony, which overlooks the Rivers of America and, you know, Pirates of the Caribbean and New Orleans Square and all that area. Yeah, well, Fantasmic comes later. Then it's time for dinner. You and your guests take your seats around a lavish table covered in white linens, fresh flowers, and set with gold-plated dinnerware and fine crystal. This is when...
It's just like an evening here at home.
Yes, it's just what we do at home. Only completely opposite. This is when the evening's adventure really begins, as a fascinating tale unfolds, told through fine food and drink, making for a unique and truly magical fine dining experience. Then, in true Disney fashion, you can end your evening with a grand finale, dessert on the private balcony, where you and your guests are treated to a spectacular view of the Rivers of America, and on certain nights, prime viewing of the park's nighttime entertainment, which, yes, of course, will be Fantasmic, which, if you've been to Disneyland, you know, takes place right there on the Rivers of America, right in front of that space.
Right.
You'll have the best view possible for that. And then, of course, that's followed usually by some sort of fireworks spectacular, which you'll have a great view of as well. And a lot of times, they also, you know, they do a lot of the projections on the castle, on It's a Small World, up and down Main Street. Well, they also do those projections on the water spray that they use for Fantasmic as well, so you can watch it there as well, so you don't miss out on any of the projections. So here is what Disney Food Blog went when they had their chance to do this. So thank you to Disney Food Blog. I'm stealing this from you. I hope you don't mind, but we're giving you publicity for it. Here is their example menu that they went through. Now, they said that they were going to do, again, these are all sculpted to what your desires are. For $15,000, you get to kind of pick what kind of food you want to have. They wanted for more of a comfort food menu. So just know that going in. This isn't necessarily what it would be like for you if you decide to invite us and pay for us and do the $15,000, but this is what they had. So they started off, here's how the courses went. Every course has a name to it, a title to every course. The first course was the Reserved and Elegant Beginning, which was golden Ostera caviar, potato pillow, and creme fraiche sabayon, which I know Michelle loves all of that. Every part of that. That just speaks to Michelle.
Exactly.
By the way, wine, exquisite wine, paired with every single course of this. I believe it was some sort of French champagne with this. I didn't list the actual wines and champagnes and everything else that they used in these, but everyone was paired with some sort of wonderful beverage as well. The next course was When Spring Calls, which had an angelotti of Iberico ham, which is some of the most high-end ham you will find anywhere, and a Toki cheese, English pea coulée, leeks, and toasted hazelnuts. Yeah.
Oh my gosh, really delicious. That's delicious.
The next course was Super Bloom, which was zucchini blossom, pheasant confit, spring onion, and zucchini blossom glacé.
Wow.
Yeah. That was followed by what is called, description was just circle. And what it was, and they said, I told you it was comfort food. It was a grilled buffalo meatloaf with rhubarb chimichurri, fava bean, and mint parmesan foam. Now, you know, you think of meatloaf, you're like, okay, yeah. Meatloaf. If you were to see the picture of this dish, if you went to Disney Food Blog and saw the picture of this dish, right. It is about the most elegant meatloaf you will ever see in your life, and it looked delicious. The next course was called Opening New Doors, which was A5 Japanese Wagyu beef, green garlic coulis, roasted beet, and Perigord sauce. Again, wow. Elegant, beautiful, lovely dish. Finally, the dessert course. There's actually kind of a two-tier dessert course thing here. The dessert was called Dream is a Wish Your Heart Makes, which was Valrhona chocolate mousse sphere. I can say that. Sphere. With passion fruit curd, strawberry essence, and lemongrass. It was also served with a tiered tray of chocolates, cookies, and caramels. And, of course, more beverages to go along with that. Yeah. And when you leave at the end of the night, you go out and watch Fantasmic and sit out there. Right. You come back, and at your seat is a gift bag for you, including a very exclusive 21 Royal pin, which you only get if you actually been there. So yes. That is how exclusive that is. Extremely, right. It was beautiful, and it's like in one of the a jewelry box and everything. It's amazing, but incredible, interesting dining experience. That is the utmost. And again, we will do 250 a piece. If anybody other wants to cover our $1,000 a piece along with the other, what would it be? $1,250,
something like that.
We're in. So just let us know. Hit us up on our email. We're in.
It's 12,500.
Yeah.
You had all the numbers.
12,500.
You were missing a zero.
12,500. Thank you.
Sorry, I'm not trying to correct you.
Parents without children. Finally, I just want to talk about one thing over at the Walt Disney World Resort, which is called Delicious Disney, a chef series that they do regularly. And actually, they have a couple scheduled still for this year. I don't know if those are going to eventually be canceled or if they'll keep on. I mean, the dining experiences are still kind of going on, some of them at Disney. So they may keep with these. But these I found very interesting. They aren't cheap. They are, I believe, $349 per person plus tax and gratuity. Right. Again, that's not added into it. So, but these are really interesting dining experiences that you may want to try if you want to splurge on a dinner sometime, because they have a lot of interesting themes to them. So it's a themed culinary event that takes place at Markham's, which is a restaurant in the private clubhouse of Golden Oak at Walt Disney World Resort. Golden Oak. I know a lot of our listeners are from Golden Oak, right? Each dining event is themed around one of the legendary Disney story tales and features delectable menus created just for the uniquely themed event. So what they have still coming up this year is the Villain Celebration, which takes place on September 21st, 2020. Wow. And that's going to be featuring, they use chefs from the Walt Disney World Resort.
Nice.
Executive Chef Scott Hunnell from Disney's Grand Floridian Resort and Spa Culinary Team is heading that one up. Later in November 16th, 2020, they're doing a Walt Disney World Resort celebration featuring chef de cuisine Daniel Cecilia from Disney's Contemporary Resort Culinary Team. So, but they've also done some other interesting things in the past. They've done experiences based on Ratatouille, Aladdin, The Lion King, the music of the Sherman Brothers, the Epcot festivals, etc. They do all sorts of these throughout the year. It's a multi-course meal, and they're designed just at the whim of the chef.
Right.
So really cool. Again, $349 per person plus tax and gratuity, but really cool and something that really kind of interests me. I mean, it's expensive. Right. I don't know if we can afford that, but at some point, maybe it might be worth a splurge night. We've done a very expensive dinners from time to time, and some of these, if one of these interesting themes calls out to you, I'm sure it's just an amazingly wonderful evening.
Right, absolutely. No, it sounds wonderful. All of those dining experiences sound amazing for sure. Now I'm going to have to rethink my birthday and Mother Day menu topic requests.
That's right. Here we go. So just some interesting stuff there. They also have, some of the food and wine festival, there's winemakers dinners and stuff like that, which are high end, that are also wonderful. But I just wanted to get through a few of those, and we'll go through more of these restaurants, Victoria and Albert's, Remy aboard Disney Cruise Line, Citrico's, Napa Rose, Steakhouse 33, some of these other high end restaurants when we get more into luxurious dining on a future episode.
Sounds good. Well, sounds yummy. All of those experiences sound like out of this world.
Yeah,
for sure.
Definitely something to try at some point. Dream. If anybody wants to invite us, we're happy to come. So that's awesome. A look at Disney dining. Let's get to some luxury experiences for Michelle.
Right. So, and really just a few, again, this could go on. And, you know, I know that also if you're going through, like if you're having a wedding and you're going through Disney for that, there's a lot of other side experiences, whether you're, you know, doing a wedding or just want a private party, you can do a lot. You can do pretty much anything you want if you have the money for it. But the things that are, you know, more achievable maybe for people to get into that are more luxurious is, club level rooms, for example, at some of the deluxe resorts, you know, and so they having a club level resort gives you advanced availability to some planners to help you plan your vacation. They have a personalized front desk and concierge when you arrive. So when you're checking in, you're kind of whisked away to the club level for that check-in. And they can help you throughout your stay if you have changes of plans or additional ideas, then they can help coordinate that for you. And they provide, they make sure you have daily housekeeping, even in some of the places like the villas that might not have daily housekeeping, but they have turn down service as well. And then, so you do have access to that room every day through your key. Mm-hmm. And we've done similar. Well, we've done club level here at Paradise Pier.
Yes, at the Disneyland Resort.
And we've done similar in the concierge on Disney Cruise Line. And so, you know, when researching what the experience is, it's very similar to those experiences. So as I mentioned, when you check in, you're whisked away to, you know, that private room for helping you get all situated and checked into your room and your resort. And, you know, during the daytime, they have like a breakfast. They have like some breakfast fare there that you can, you know, some are grab and go, some are, you know, more heated. And I'm sure right now things are very different.
Right,
so I'm just talking more what the typical club level would provide. And then throughout the day, they have different types of food that they might bring out, like snack type foods, maybe light lunch fare. And then in the evening, they have hors d'oeuvres and cocktails. And, you know, they really do try to also feature some of the cuisines from other resorts, which is kind of nice if you're staying at one resort and you get to try some of the, you know, food and experiences that you might get introduced to for that takes place at another resort. So
right.
It's kind of nice that regards.
And a lot of times, especially like, well, I mean, throughout the day, but especially it's nice during the, you know, happy hour time when they have the snacks and, you know, some cocktails out, wine, you know, whatever the case may be. They have usually have like a television with cartoons playing so the kids can go and sit and enjoy that. So the adults can have a little time and the kids can have, you know, enjoy it as well with their snacks too. But it, so it doesn't, you know, you can actually kind of relax from the day if you've had a busy day at the parks or whatever the case may be.
Right. Exactly. You know, and some of the club levels have really great views for fireworks or other evening entertainment like that that takes place. So there, you know, I know that there's a lot of question of whether it's worth it or not. And that's really very personal to say whether something is worth it or not. But it again, it just takes, you know, one, your room is going to be at a nicer location and nicer, you know, usually a higher level. But access to this, you know, more private, intimate club area is also a nice feature, luxurious feature.
Right. As having done club level and done concierge on Disney Cruise Line, if you break it down just by dollars and cents, looking for value, see if it's worth it. It is not.
No.
If you just break it down like that. But then if you add in, you know, emotional experiences, some things the way you feel, like, we've not done concierge as much recently, just because of the, you know, we've decided it isn't worth it financially for us. But there's, and most of it I don't miss, but the one thing I miss is when you first, you're one of the first ones to board aboard Disney Cruise Line to do concierge. You are one of the first ones to get on board. And then, like you said, you are whisked away to what used to be to the Cadillac Lounge, at least when the Disney Wonder and the Disney Magic. Now that they have their own concierge lounge. Yeah. You're whisked away to there and you get cocktails immediately and snacks. And then the concierge comes and meets with you and talks about your plans for your entire trip, asks if there's anything you need. There's usually a representative from like some of the fine dining, like Paolo or Remy there that will, if you want to get some extra reservations, they'll help you with that. And talk to you about maybe if you don't know if you want to do Remy or not, which happened to us.
Right.
It's like, and they talked to us about it and we were sold on it and we did it. It's really that day, that first time you board and you just get this first class experience.
Right.
That is that's the one thing that I miss not doing concierge. The rest of it, I love the lounge. I love the coffee machine.
Right.
I love the snacks all day. I love the happy hours at night.
Right.
You know, but when you break it down that financially, it's just not quite worth it. Doesn't mean we won't do it again.
Right.
It just we don't do it like we did for a short period of time where we were doing it. But it again, if you break it down dollars and cents, not worth it. But when you throw some of the way you feel, the way they make you feel, some of the joy you receive, some of this feeling like you're just part of the upper crust, a little bit of that Downton Abbey getting served by people thing, you know, going on. Sometimes it feels worth it.
Definitely. Or, you know, sometimes there's an experience you really wanted to try to get arranged for that you couldn't get it arranged prior to your travel. Maybe they can, maybe they can't, but you have a better chance that they can get something arranged. You know, and we've had that happen to us on multiple times. So it is a nice, luxurious experience. And like you said, it's dollars and cents. You're not going to have a way to really make it of value. But from like you said, it's more the personal experience that you have and the fun that you have, and it does take a load off of you sometimes. And you know, sometimes when we're traveling with our son, you know, that we do need sometimes that area that maybe, you know, where we can get somebody to help us with getting something arranged that might have been unattainable.
So it's, again, it's up to you. You know, it's what is of value to you. I love concierge, but again, I'm not willing to pay for it every single time. But again, we could possibly do it again at some point in the future.
So. Right. Yeah, definitely. So Disney has what they call signature services, and that's available to anybody staying in a club level or a suite. If you're arranging a private VIP tour, or, you know, through group sales, they also provide this service that you can contact them. And they really help, again, similar to what we talk about with the club level, they can help you plan your trip and coordinate a lot more with traveling and getting things just the way you want when you're coming to experience Walt Disney World. They can also help when it's available. Right now it's not, but in-room celebrations and gifts, they can help sell, you know, coordinate that. Obviously dining reservations, or, you know, again, it's not going on right now, but specialty cakes and things like that. So little extras that you might be able to coordinate for your room that you wouldn't be able to otherwise, you know, get. So, you know, those are definitely some nice features that Disney Signature Services.
It's like having guest services, like rather than having to go to guest services and wait in line and connect with somebody, it's like they're just right there at your beck and call, almost,
and you can access them before your trip, which is really nice to help coordinate that, you know. And some of the other things that they can help coordinate through is you know, as we mentioned, the VIP tour, which is really a customized tour that you can take, and it is luxurious, you know, from what I understand,
having never done it,
but it's not something you have to be staying at one of their nicer resorts. Anybody can certainly coordinate that. And if you do book that, then obviously you have all of Disney's signature services at your service as well. You know, and then other things like arranging for cabanas. Again, you could do that on your own if you wanted to stay at, you know, rent a cabana for the day at one of the resort pools that has those, but they can help coordinate through that as well. So, you know, again, they can really help, you know, coordinate things that, yes, you could possibly do, but here makes it easier. Just one contact.
Absolutely.
So
very good.
You know, but the other thing I wanted to break down, when, you know, we're talking about luxury resorts and we talked about the highest end rooms that are most unique rooms that they have available. But there's, it's also and we talked a little bit about it, like you said, if you're combining families to cover the cost of these 3 bedrooms or 2 bedroom bungalows and things like that. But you know, a 1 bedroom, you may feel like, hey, a 1 bedroom suite is doable, mm-hmm. you know. And again, I've known people and you know who have Disney Vacation Club and they pool points to do 1 bedrooms mm-hmm. and things like that, you know, but just that is you're staying at a luxury or what they call deluxe resort, mm-hmm. You know, and you're having all the perks of that and all the comfort and convenience. A 1 bedroom does have a full kitchen with dishwasher and all the dishes and wine glasses and, you know, dinnerware, et cetera. And it does have the washer and dryer. So, you know, everything that we talked about in terms of having some conveniences and features are available in the 1 bedroom mm-hmm. because they also have the sitting room and dining room table, et cetera. So you could have that luxury experience if you're, you know, wanting to look for something that's more attainable, such as a 1 bedroom.
Right.
You know, and so, you know, there's two different ways that I saw that you could do this. Obviously, you can go straight through Walt Disney World reservations, or, you know, or obviously your travel agent and pay for those rooms. Mm-hmm. And obviously, if you're a Disney Vacation Club, use your points. But you can also, we've talked about this slightly in the past, is, you know, rent points from somebody who is a Vacation Club owner. And so I just did a sample comparison of picking a week in January, for example, or not actually a whole week, just several days. Like, so January 24th through 28th. So it's like a Sunday through Thursday.
So some of them would be a little less expensive period.
Right.
Friday and Saturday, as you would expect, usually tend to be a little higher.
Exactly. So at the Animal Kingdom, Kidani, getting a Savannah view. Right now, if you went to Walt Disney World, it would be $748 a night.
That's without any... some of the annual pass discounts or any of that, right?
That's just right now the current going rate there. If you were to rent Disney Vacation Club, and right now what I'm seeing is the rental fee is about $20, so averaging $19 to $21 going through a third party. You might get it cheaper going directly with somebody mm-hmm. Individually, but that's kind of like a ballpark figure there. So if you were to rent Disney Vacation Club points for that, it would save you $128 a night. Mm. Now, again, as you mentioned, that's comparing with no AP discounts or any other seasonal discounts that might be going on. And January, you would tend to see either a seasonal or a vacation or an annual pass discount.
Still not cheap, but you know, if you're, if you want to splurge, it's a way to splurge.
Right. And again, you know,
still save a little money.
Yeah, you could fit, you know, several people into that, to that, mm-hmm. You know, to, you know, maybe small families.
Right.
And then same time period for the Riviera 1 bedroom standard view. Right now, that is on the Walt Disney World website at $810 a night. If you were to rent Vacation Club points, saying $20 a point, that would come to $665 a night. So you're saving $145 a night doing it that approach. So, and there's pros and cons, obviously, to which way you want to go. There's the saving money is definitely with a pro account, you know, approach to it, going through rental points, but you are going through an outside third party, mm-hmm. or you may be directly with an individual, but your ability to control some things.
Well, you're not in much control at it at all, because they have to pretty much handle booking everything and making sure that things go through. You know, you don't get a lot of that stuff.
Right. So, you know, there's that. And this is not taking into consideration if you use a travel agent and you might get some perks through a travel agent. You know, it's trying to compare apples to apples right now. But obviously, that savings would seem to diminish once you add in other discounts that Walt Disney World might throw in.
And obviously that's still way too high for most people. And, you know, they're still not going to be able to afford to pay that. But if you ever do feel like, oh, this is a special vacation, maybe it's a, you know, special wedding anniversary or, you know, special celebration for somebody else or whatever, and you feel like, you know, hey, we can splurge once, you know,
and something.
You also have to throw into the equation that, yes, there is a full kitchen there. So you may be able to save a little bit on the food by, you know, having some meals there. dinner there, a breakfast there, right, or whatever the case may be. You may be able to save a little bit of money that way on, that you would normally spend if you were in a regular hotel room, right, and having to dine basically three meals at the parks, right, or the, exactly, resorts or whatever every single day. So you, right, have to actually add all that into the equation.
Definitely. Yeah. So anyways, wanted to know then, you know, like what your thoughts are. And I know we had some people who also got involved in what they thought would be a luxury experience going to Disney parks.
Sure. So my thoughts are always like, it just depends on the vacation that we're going on. Sometimes it's fine staying in a basic bare bones room, right, or whatever the case may be. But there's other times when I know we're going to be relaxing more, maybe spending some more, mm-hmm, time in the room, especially with our son who can only go for so long in the, right, parks before he starts to wear down and, you know,
meltdown.
Yeah. So we may spend a
or
little more.
Or you meltdown, me meltdown.
Well, yeah. Everybody has a meltdown at some point, right? So we may spend a little more time in the room. So we may want a little, right, nicer room, mm-hmm, or a little more space where we can, you know, he can go do his thing in the, right, bedroom and we can do our thing in the living room. Right. So, yeah, we'll do a one bedroom.
Have different TVs going on.
Yeah. Yeah. So, it, you know, it's just what you weigh into what your vacation, mm-hmm, you want is. And then you have to weigh the financial factor in, right, that and what is best for you. So, you know, that's just kind of my thoughts on it. It's just, you know, weigh it out. It doesn't necessarily... not everything is right for every single vacation. Right. It just kind of depends on what you're thinking. Again, if you're going roped fireworks probably at the park, you probably can go with a more bare bones room because, sure, you're not spending a lot of time in, right, the room. However, if you're, you know, thinking more of a luxurious vacation, you want to spend a little more time on the resort, right, a little more time in the room, then you may want to splurge a little more on it. So it's completely up to you.
Right.
So, here's some from some of our listeners. Basically, I put out there, look, if money wasn't a problem, if it was not an issue, what would your dream, mm-hmm, Disney vacation consist of? What would you do? You know, right, so we were hit up immediately. This was from somebody who subscribes to the newsletter, Scott in Minneapolis, yes, who's chimed in many times with us. He hit me up with an email pretty quickly after we put this out. He said, hello, Tom and Michelle. Who hasn't been daydreaming of their next Disney adventure? Right. If money was no object, I'd go all out. Insert Peter Pan sound effects. Okay, everybody, here we go.
I love it.
He says, I'd grab my wife and daughter and start with a couple of days at the OG Disneyland in California Adventure, nice, staying at the Grand Californian. Yes. Yes. From there, we'd fly to Tokyo Disney and spend a few experiencing Japan, then to Shanghai Disney,
wow, nice,
and Disney Hong Kong to see what the Chinese have to offer. Then off to Paris for a week, and of course, visiting Disneyland Paris. We pop over to jolly old England, spend some time in, wow, London before taking the train to Dover and taking a transatlantic Disney cruise, ending up in Castaway Key. Well, I don't think you'd end up in Castaway Key, but you could stop, oh, there before you finish.
Yeah.
And then he said we'd have to finish up the week at the Grand Floridian at Walt Disney World. Problem is, after a trip like that, every other trip would pale in comparison, but it's just a dream, right? I agree. That's a magnificent around, true, the world Disney trip. It'd probably take you a good month and a half, 2 months to knock that all out. But,
right.
That would be fantastic. So, gosh, thank you, Scott, in Minneapolis.
Really love
appreciate
that.
That. Yeah. Adam hit us up on Twitter. You can find him. He's from the Mouse and More podcast. You can find him at the Mouse and More. He said Club 33, 21 Royal, nice, fireworks cruise with catered dinner, Napa Rose chef's table, and dining with an Imagineer, which is actually something, well, we've done lunch with an Imagineer, right, not dinner with an Imagineer. We've done lunch with an, right, Imagineer, but that is a wonderful experience.
Yes.
It's a splurge, but recommend it if you have the money to go out, because at least, I mean, again, your results may vary. I've heard that depending on how interesting the Imagineer is, because they're not the same Imagineer every time, that,
right,
it could, your experience could be a little different. We were lucky. We had a great one.
Yes.
He was excellent. So, Nate and Serena hit us up again. They are the DVC Duo. You can find them on Twitter at DVC Duo, and check out their amazing blog, right, at dvcduo.com. They said, oh, wow, where do we start? Chef's table at Victoria and Albert's, a bungalow at the Polynesian Resort and Spa, mm-hmm, fireworks from Grand One Yachts, this is, yes, something we didn't bring up, a private VIP tour, and oh yeah, buy a house at Golden Oak. One can dream, right? Yes, for sure. I love when we joined Vacation Club, they send us a pamphlet for Golden Oak,
right?
You must be interested in Golden Oak. I'm like, oh, what's Golden Oak? Looking in the price of these houses where they started, I'm like, no, we are not in that market right now, but thank you very much, appreciate that. Katie Lorraine hit us up on Twitter. You can find her at KT_Lorraine78. She said, stay at Bay Lake Tower and dinner with an Imagineer. Very nice. Yeah. Young Adventures hit us up. You can find them on Twitter at Young_FamilyYT and also find them on YouTube. They do a great YouTube channel. One thing would be a super long stay. We usually stay for two nights and try to fit in as much as we can, trying to balance between park and resort activities. It would be awesome to stay for like 14 days and do everything we could ever want to do, LOL.
Yes.
That's long stays are the best.
Right.
Because you get that nice balance of park time, resort time, really getting to explore when you're at Walt Disney World.
Right.
Long stays are awesome. Jessica Lee Wilson hit us up on Twitter. You can find her at JLeeZ. She said, dinner at Victoria and Albert's. Also, if money were no issue, I'd have a Disney wedding and be able to bring all our family and friends along. Our wedding budget in our hometown is the same as we'd spend at Disney for a wedding, the same size, but not all our family and friends could afford to travel.
Sure,
so I
right.
totally get that.
Yes.
So thank you, Jessica.
Good idea, though.
Pat and Charles from the Conversations podcast hit us up. Yes, you can find them at Swations. Do Disney dream experiences count? Because if they do, we'd gather a group of our best friends. I hope we're among that group, Pat and Charles. And do an all-expensive paid exclusive tour through Galaxy's Edge. Lightsabers for all, rides and Ronto Rap for breakfast, lunch, and dinner, and to go.
Right.
I noticed you mentioned, like, maybe you might want to do a little variety on that. Love Ronto Wrap.
Right.
For the 12th Ronto Wrap, something different. Finally, we are hit up by Keenan and Rachel from Part of Our World podcast. You can find them at POOW podcast.
Right.
And they said, this isn't a thing yet. I think it's obviously from Keenan. This isn't a thing yet, but when it is, I won't have enough money for it. Galactic Star Cruiser. Yes, that is the one thing that we are definitely going to dream about and somehow save up enough money to do Galactic Star Cruiser. Assuming, I think they're still going through with it. Assuming it's still going through.
Right.
So thanks everybody for chiming in. Really appreciate that. If you have any more Disney dream luxury experiences that you'd like to have as part of your next vacation or dream vacation or whatever the case may be, feel free to hit us up through social media or through our email, and we'll bring it up on another episode coming up in the future.
Right. As I mentioned, there's just so much luxury that you can arrange for that goes beyond the resorts that we could do multiple episodes.
We didn't even touch on the luxury experiences that we could have
Right.
For, and we'll
like
get
some of the ones
of
that, that were brought up, you know, like the yacht and, you know, like I touched on with the cabanas and things. What's really great is there are a lot of luxury things that you can do as a day guest or whatever. So I think that's another whole episode that, that
for
we
sure.
can
Yeah, we just, we, after just doing this, we built up like four or five more episodes.
I know. It's like there's a lot of stuff.
Lots of stuff. So. And thanks again for everybody for chiming in. And that is a look exploring Disney luxury.
First class, up in the sky, popping champagne, living my life in the fast lane. I want to change by the flowers. Oh, the flowers.
It's good to dream, isn't it?
Yes.
Boy, I would love to do so many of the experiences. Some we've been blessed to be able to do a few of them, but there are so many that we'll never get a chance to do, but I would love to do them at some point.
Right.
And again, I know people bring up the fact like, oh, you know, is it really worth it financially? I think we had even somebody chime in on Twitter saying, you know, I've done this, I've done that, I've done that. None of them seemed really worth it. I'm like, okay, well, fine. But it's, again, if you look at it dollars and cents wise, a lot of these experiences aren't necessarily worth it, but just the luxury, just the feeling you have when you're doing it.
And convenience.
Yeah.
And
it sometimes comfort will feel more worth it than really it is if you were to break it down on the bottom line.
Right, exactly.
So let's get to our Disney stories of the week. Not a lot this week, but I do have a couple of stories for you this week, all involving Disney Plus. So let's get right to it. There's a new series exploring the wildlife at Disney that can be found at Disney parks that's coming to Disney Plus. This from people.com of all places where I found this. On Wednesday, Disney Plus announced a new original docuseries from National Geographic that will give subscribers an inside look at Disney's Animal Kingdom Park, Disney's Animal Kingdom Lodge, and the Seas with Nemo and Friends at Epcot.
Wow.
Yeah. The 8-episode docuseries, Magic of Disney's Animal Kingdom, although they're obviously looking at Epcot too,
right,
will be narrated by Josh Gad.
Yay.
One of our favorites for sure. And we'll introduce viewers to some of the more than 300 species and 5,000 plus enchanting animals that are part of the Disney parks. And we'll also cover the Herculean tasks animal care experts undertake to keep the parks running and the animals healthy. So that sounds
fun. That is cool. You know? Yeah, I love that behind the scenes.
Right. I mean, some of you get to do some of the tours or whatever where you get a little glimpse into that. But this is really going to give you, a better look than you possibly could from, even one of those tours. So Josh Gad had this to say in a statement, quote, Magic of Disney's Animal Kingdom captures the spirit of those two world famous parks and its animals and ushers that feeling directly into viewing rooms. Each episode, we get to know these animals intimately and are immersed in the magic of Disney. And it's been a joy giving a voice to this ultimate adventure, unquote.
Very cool.
Yeah, very cool. This series will debut on Disney Plus on Friday, September 25th. Again, Magic of Disney's Animal Kingdom, although they do look a little at Epcot as well. So really cool.
Yeah.
I'm excited. I love animals. Definitely. And I love Josh Gad. I'm excited to see this series.
Yeah, I think it's going to be really interesting and fun. I think obviously there's going to be a lot to learn from it, and that's going to be great too. And I'm glad you like animals.
Yeah, I do like animals. And parents without children. Finally, next story. There's another infamous special that is getting a remake for Disney Plus in sort of block form.
Okay.
This from Variety.com. One of the most infamous events in Star Wars history is getting resurrected on Disney Plus through the lens of Legos.
Nice.
Yes.
Yay.
The Lego Star Wars Holiday Special.
Woohoo!
Yes. Will debut on the streaming service on November 17th. Yet after the events of Star Wars, The Rise of Skywalker, and the special continues the partnership between Lucasfilm and Lego of making playful, tongue-in-cheek animated versions of Star Wars story using Lego figures and blocks. The 45-minute special will follow Rey as her further investigation of the Force launches her in BB-8 across the history of the Skywalker saga as Finn, Poe, Rose and Chewbacca prepare for the Star Wars Holiday Life Day on Chewie's home planet of Kashyyyk.
Love it. Love it.
Yeah. So, if you've ever tried, you can find it if you go to YouTube. I think it has been up there in the past. Try to watch the original Star Wars Holiday Special. It is horrendous.
Painful.
It is really tough to watch. But you can take it for the comedy of it if you want and just laugh at it. But it is really interesting. But this is kind of interesting. We love the Lego Star Wars stuff that they put out there. There's a lot of them already on Disney Plus.
Some of the animated things and the games.
Yeah. Just always funny. I'm really excited for this. This sounds interesting. A rep for Lucasfilm tells Variety that a few, quote, Star Wars and quote actors will reprise their roles for the special, but it's still unclear whether Daisy Ridley, John Boyega, Oscar Isaac, or Kelly Marie Tran are returning. So they say that it wouldn't surprise me. Anthony Daniels does everything. So if there's anything with C-3PO, probably Anthony Daniels be a part of
it. Yes, which is so awesome.
Right. But we'll see about some of the others if they're part of it. What is clear is that the Lego Holiday Special directly evokes the 1978 Star Wars Holiday Special that aired on CBS on the same date, November 17th.
Oh, wow.
Yep, that special starred all the original Star Wars actors, including Mark Hamill, Harrison Ford, Carrie Fisher, Anthony Daniels, and Peter Mayhew, and introduced the concept of Life Day as a special holiday Luke, Leia, Han, and Chewie celebrated after the events of Star Wars A New Hope. Yes, try and search for it. If you haven't ever seen it, just go and check it out.
I don't know.
just so you know how horrific it is. It is amazing that that thing was ever made. And it just, you know, it's kind of just been pushed out to the, we don't remember that at all. Whatever happened with that. I saw somebody else post out there, like, if you think that's bad, there was a Donnie Marie Star Wars special that someone posted a picture of, or maybe it was a little video. I don't know. I saw it on social media that looked even worse.
Oh my gosh.
I don't know. But fascinating stuff. But I'm glad that Lego's coming back. This should be interesting,
yes,
no matter what.
Definitely. So,
and I'm sure, like I said, tongue in cheek, it'll be funny just the same.
Yeah, most definitely. Cool.
So that's it for the Disney stories of the week. However, we never leave you without giving you some sort of tip that might help you on your next vacation, whether it be Walt Disney World Resort, the Disneyland Resort, Disney Cruise Line, once they get rolling again, hopefully sooner than later. And we always start with Michelle, one, because look at her. She's awesome and wonderful, beautiful. Luxury in essence right there, but she also has the very best tip, so let's get right to it. Here's Michelle's tip of the week.
You're so sweet, so kind. So my tip, I tried to kind of go with our theme from today and talking about luxury resorts, and so I actually have two.
Okay,
so the first one
tips
is
of the week.
Yes, the first one is just kind of comical information that I ran across. And, you know, if you've ever stayed at one of the Disney luxury or deluxe resorts, you might have had a wonderful sleep. And that might have been because you're on vacation at a really great, you know, place, but it might have been the bed. And you can actually own a Disney mattress.
It's a used one. Please tell me it's a new one.
No, they're brand new. I'm not going to advertise. If you will include information on the newsletter about this, or you can send us an email if you want to know what brand. But it's actually, this brand has a Disney mattress.
Well, feel free, this brand, to advertise with us if you want.
Right.
We will sell you every week. And we will take a Disney bed by that.
So that way you could have some of your own Disney at home, right?
Right.
And so that's just my one tip. But the other tip is also has to do with staying at a resort. So whether it's you want to go back to the same resort and, you know, really would like to see if you can get the same room that you had, or you've heard of an area or in a resort that you'd like to try to stay at, you know, you can certainly ask. You can put in a request. There's when you're booking online, there's some request features mm-hmm. that you can indicate things like different resorts have different ones that they offer, like whether it's close to an elevator, on a higher floor, or, you know, near things like that. Near, I think, pools might be one of them. I can't remember now off the top of my head. But if you really have something specific, let's, as I mentioned, you want to ask for a specific room, obviously they can't guarantee it, but you can call the resort. You know, generally speaking, about 4 or 5 days before your arrival, have your reservation number available when you're calling them. And, you know, let them know what you're looking for. And if they can't provide you that same room, let them know what's important about mm-hmm. it. Now, obviously, like if you're trying to say, hey, we stayed in this room on our honeymoon and it's our, you know, special anniversary, we want that room. I know they'll try, but they might not be able to get that, but they certainly will try. But if there's features that you're interested in, you know, for example, we talked about staying at Bay Lake mm-hmm. Tower and liking the lake view. We tend to go on the side that faces the monorail station mm-hmm. and that way we're seeing the monorail coming towards mm-hmm. us, whereas you could get a lake view on the other side and it might be a little bit more secluded looking. So it letting them know what you're interested in, you know, in addition to the room request, so that if they can't provide you that exact same room, they could accommodate maybe something that is similar or meets, you know, the feature that you're looking for, you know, and obviously share with them, you know, if it is your anniversary and you did have your honeymoon there, let them know that. Or if it's a special birthday or it's your first time ever staying on property mm-hmm. and somebody told you this area would be great, let them know that so that they can at least indicate that on your reservation. And as they're playing Sudoku with trying to put people in rooms, they can have that additional information.
Yeah, we've done it many times. Yes, we've done it at Bay Lake Tower, and we have at times gotten the exact same room we requested, one that we love, the space that we love. Right. Also, we've done it at the cabins at Fort Wilderness because there's, depending on where your cabin is, you can be closer to the road or you can be kind of more away from it. Now, if you want to get a quick walk, because, you know, one thing, while the cabins are great, there are, you know, you have to catch a bus to catch another bus or catch a bus to catch a boat. So there are some transportations. And if you don't, issues is so if you don't want to walk as far, maybe, you know, you have little ones that don't want to walk as far, then maybe you want one closer to the bus stations or whatever the case may be. But we kind of like to be a little more secluded, as you know, have more views of wilderness, more views, and a little quieter where the buses aren't coming by all the time. Exactly. You know, so we will pick our own. We have a particular spaces that we like, so we've requested areas there, and we've almost always, maybe not getting the exact cabin we wanted, but definitely the area that we've wanted every single time.
So. And it helps if you can give them some, like I said, either a variety of what area that you want, like you're saying with the cabin, we've usually specified the loop and, you know, kind of maybe three or four that we like, or in one of the resorts, again, what floor or what side to face and things like that. Again, and when you're talking to them, let them know you totally understand they might not be able to accommodate that request, but you know, they generally do their best to try to get something about your request to be fitting in for your vacation.
That's very true.
So don't be afraid to ask. Give them a call.
Definitely. Michelle's tips. Always the best tips. Let's get to my tip of the week. I'm also going to base it on what our topic was, our main topic for this week. And I'm going to talk about, although we didn't really touch much on Disney Cruise Line, I'm going to talk about if you ever have a Disney Cruise book, the process, I've talked about this in the past, the process for upgrading your cabin. Mm-hmm. You know, you don't have to necessarily purchase concierge prior to it. You may be able to get lucky and get the concierge cabin, if that's what you want, for a bit lower price, actually a significantly lower price than what you would buy if you were to get it in advance. Now, I will say this right off the bat. If when you're booking your Disney Cruise Line room, make sure whatever you book is a room you'd be comfortable staying in, because there's no guarantees that you can move to a different cabin within it. So make sure whatever cabin you're in, that will be good enough for you. Now, if you want to take a look when you get to the cruise port to see if there's something available and a different level, whether it be just moving up a couple categories or whether you want to go all the way up to concierge or, you know, who knows, maybe even the Royal Suite if you're willing to pay for it. You can always get there. First thing you do is when you arrive at the port, go and check in as you would normally, get your key card, get your picture taken, all that stuff, get ready to go. Then you head over to the supervisor's counter, and there should be a sign there saying if there are no upgrades available, there'll be a sign there saying there's no upgrades available because the ship is completely booked or whatever the case may be. You can also ask when you check in, and they may know and when you check in, but they may not. But you head over there, there may be a line, there may not be. You go in and you check in with them, and then you say, look, you know, I'm looking for cabins that are higher than whatever my level is. And then they'll go down a chart and they'll look and see what's available, and then they'll quote you an extra price on, okay, you're in such and such category if you want to go up to a window, if you want to go up to a balcony, if you want to go up to concierge, and the different levels of concierge, they'll tell you this is the price for it. And then you can decide if you want to pay that extra money to get into that level. Again, it will be significantly less than if you were to book it ahead of time, but there are no guarantees that you get it. And you also do not get the benefit of the concierge, the shoreside concierge that you get of booking things early before you ever get on the cruise. But it may be a way that you can get from an inside to a window or an inside to a balcony or a window to a balcony or whatever you want. You know, it's just a way to add a little more luxury, add, yes, more money, but maybe not what you'd be paying if you were booking it ahead of time.
Right. And we've had We've traveled with somebody who actually went from an interior up to concierge. Funny thing, on our last one on our Panama Canal, we were right behind the person who took the very last concierge room. One person ahead. We could have gotten it.
It's so funny. They were right next to us checking at the supervisor's desk. We were looking to see. We weren't sure if we were going to upgrade to concierge, but we were looking to see what the price would be.
Right.
And the person that got there right in front of us took the very last concierge cab. And we were like, we were listening to it.
Yeah,
and
she
we were
was like, thinking about it.
Yeah, like, don't waving her off or whatever. And so we didn't end up. We stayed with the cabin we had because we were happy with the cabin we had. We just wanted to see if we could get concierge for a much lower price.
And it would have been an amazing savings from when booking a concierge ahead of time. Right. You know.
So.
But so sometimes it does work. Sometimes it doesn't. You know, and it doesn't matter, even if you've gotten your cabin at the lowest price that it was ever published at, the upgrade is going to be, cost is going to be the same as if somebody paid more for the same cabin that you're booked into.
Exactly.
You know, so your savings might be even greater.
Right. So, I mean, it all depends on, again, make sure that if, like, say you book an inside cabin, make sure you're happy with an inside cabin, because in all likelihood, you're probably going to be still in that inside cabin. But there are options if you should want to look into into going into a different cabin. So,
and for right now, since Disney is being a little bit more lenient on its cancellation requirements and fees, and obviously they don't want people getting on a ship that they might be ill, you might have more opportunity, because they may allow for more late cancellations of a cruise, and then you might get an opportunity to upgrade.
We'll see. It's still up in the air on when Disney Cruise is going to get to be able to actually sail again. They keep pushing it back, but hopefully it won't be too much longer before we can get back on board and begin sailing with Captain Mickey and Captain Minnie once again.
And you could also ask about upgrading on the hotel rooms, which we've done that before, where we've, you know, been on Disney Vacation Club points and asked for the availability of a, you know, higher level room or whatever, and you know, sometimes
going from a regular to a club level or whatever the case may be.
Different things, you know, you can ask when you're checking in, and they'll try to help you out.
Don't expect that you're going to get it for free. I mean, sometimes that happens. Sometimes you get a little pixie dust and they bump you up to something for free, but don't expect it.
So
don't be upset if they quote you, we can move you up to a one bedroom suite, but it's going to cost this much more money. That's probably what likely is going to happen. But you never know. It's worth asking, finding out what the amount is. Maybe you get bumped up. You know, maybe you get the pixie dust, you get bumped up for free, or maybe it's within your price range that you feel it's worth going for. So that's it for this week. Next week, well, we're counting down the days until Phineas and Ferb, the movie, Candace Against the Universe, comes to Disney Plus on August 28th. And to celebrate that, we are going to kind of take a look into the original series and talk all about why we love that show so much.
Right. And, you know, sadly, we did not learn to appreciate that show when it was actually a current thing. We've watched it now, you know, as well, now on Disney Plus, but, you know, after the show had already ended. And I have to say, I was judging a book by its cover. The look of it did not appeal to me. It looked really weird, and I thought, where is Disney going with this? You know, but I don't know. We watched it one time with the Star Wars episode and just realized it was really funny, smart humor. It obviously appeals to kids, and it's just great. So don't judge our episode by its cover for next week. Give it a chance. And if you haven't ever watched Phineas or Ferb, you know, give it a chance and let us kind of walk you through it.
Yeah, we're going to talk about how, you know, look, there's a lot of things for the entire family age groups if you watch this show, including adults. We can, as adults, watch this show and laugh at it, because there's a lot of things that are highly actually intellectual within this that you have to think about, and that kids will never get, but the adults will totally get every time they see it. It's really interesting. If you've watched Phineas and Ferb, love Phineas and Ferb, hopefully, you know, our exploration of it will kind of, you know, bring it all back, all the memories, all the good times, and get you prepared for Candace Against the Universe. Never seen it. We're trying to tell you why you might enjoy it. You might want to give it a chance. Give it a few episodes. I wouldn't suggest just watching one episode and saying, okay, that's good enough. Watching a few episodes, just like any series, watching a few episodes and finding out that, hey, this is pretty good. And we're going to, you know, talk all about that next week. So as for this week, we appreciated that you joined us today. In the future, you can find us most everywhere you get podcasts. However, the very best place to find us is on our own website, HyperionAdventuresPodcast.com. And while you're there,
sign up for the newsletter. Yes. You get a lot of extras.
Right. Please sign up for the newsletter. We only send it out once a week. We don't like just flood your inbox with a bunch of stuff. You know, it just, we send out a newsletter. Usually it's on Tuesday, sometimes Wednesday, but most often it's on Tuesday, mid-morning, afternoon, depending on where you are. And it just kind of tells you what's going on with Hyperion Adventures as far as episodes, the stuff we have going on. We connect with a little Disney Dishes blog in there as well. And we will have the next category for the Hyperion Adventures Disney Hall of Fame there. You will be the first to receive that. You can also follow us on social media. We're on Twitter at Hyperion Podcast, Facebook, Instagram, Pinterest at Hyperion Adventures Podcast. We are on YouTube. This episode should be coming up on YouTube. Just so you can see Michelle's PowerPoint presentation, you should check that out. If you want to find us, just do a search for Hyperion Adventures Podcast. And once we come up, just hit subscribe. And every time we have a new video coming up, you will be the first to know, including whenever I do my piratey dance and lip sync thing. You'll get to check that out. And if you ever want to connect with us in other ways, you can always email us at our Gmail account, HyperionAdventuresPodcast@gmail.com.
Right. We love to hear from you. Love to hear your feedback, sharing some of your ideas with our topics. And we really do appreciate connecting with you. And we also love it when you tell a friend about our podcast.
Yeah, please tell your friends about the show. If you have time, more time, give us a rating. Even more time than that, give us a review. It helps in so many ways. That's it. Thank you for listening to another episode of the Hyperion Adventures Podcast. We look forward to sharing some time with you again next week. Until that time, I'm Tom.
I'm Michelle.
And we hope that you have a magical week.